Hey.
How's
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Chatsworth Baptist Church this morning. It is wonderful to see you here in the house of the Lord. The Lord has given us a beautiful day. Amen. You can praise Him for that. We're going to start our service this morning by singing number 143 in our hymn books. 143, I Stand Amazed in the Presence. We'll stand together and sing all four verses. 143.
Brother Matt Murphy, would you open our service in prayer this morning, sir? Amen. You may be seated. Again, we do welcome you this morning. It is a joy and blessing to see each one of you here this morning. If you're visiting with us, we're especially glad to have you with us. You are our honored guest. Daniel, it's good to see you. Amen. Yeah, it's good to see your family too. Praise the Lord. Yeah, it's good to see all of you this morning. It's a blessing to be together to worship the Lord together this morning. Let me mention some of the announcements in your bulletin. Choir practice at 4:45. And this evening at 6 o'clock, we'll continue our series on the miracles of Christ. And then you'll note immediately following the evening service, we'll have a VBS meeting. So that's right around the corner. In fact, there's an insert in your bulletin about that. Vacation Bible School, July 25th through the 29th. We'll be here before you know it, our meeting tonight. And we're going to be seeing some exciting ideas for Cowabunga Farms. And maybe you've helped in VBS before, maybe you haven't, but we need you. And this little form is helpful to us. If you'll fill it out and check areas that you'd be interested in serving in, and give it back to Jen, then we'll kind of know how to position people and know how to fill in the gap. So if you could help us with that, we would be much appreciative of that. And again, we'll meet right after the service this evening. Wednesday evening, you note the change there. There will be our first quarter business meeting, so there will be no regular prayer meeting as such, nor will there be CIA or junior and senior high youth group in lieu of our business meeting. Ladies' lunch at the Olive Garden this Friday at 12:30. All ladies invited out for that. And youth group Bible study this Friday night at 6 o'clock. You will see the red insert, CFBC calendar dates to save. So a lot of good things coming up in the near future that we hope you can be a part of. And this will be helpful to you to mark your calendars and remind you of these things that we have coming up. Praise the Lord for a good work day yesterday, and thanks to all who came out. We had a good group of folks out yesterday. We got a lot done inside and out, and so we're very grateful for that. We had a wonderful time of fellowship together. But again, it's a joy and blessing to see each of you here this morning. Brother Steve will come and lead us in our offertory hymn.
Thank you, Pastor. 176 for our offertory hymn this morning. Do I have that right? 176, yes. It's Jesus, the very thought of thee. Remain seated. We'll sing the first, third, and fifth. Prayer for the offering.
Father, we do thank you again for this beautiful day you've given to us. It's your day, Father. Help us each to remember that this is your day to worship you. Thank you for us together safely. Yes, now, Father, we bless the offering that it will be used wisely for missions and for church needs for the family here at church. Thank you, Father, in Christ's name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to be faithful. Amen. 478 as we continue singing this morning, 478 in our hymn books. It is well with my soul. We'll stand together to sing all four verses. The junior church will be dismissed on the second. 478.
When
Amen. Boy, I like that. That's good. Y'all sound good singing it too. Amen. Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. As we continue our series, through the book of Genesis. We have been out of it for a few weeks due to mission conferences and Easter and different things going on. Last time we saw in the first six verses the fall of man into sin. Now this morning we're going to see what happened after Adam and Eve sinned. What happened after they sinned? We're going to pick it up in verse 7. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity, that means warfare, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Let's pray. Our Father, we love you. We thank you for your infallible, inerrant, inspired, unadulterated, pure word this morning. We pray that you'd use it in our hearts, speak to our hearts, challenge our hearts, cleanse our hearts, convict our hearts, change our hearts, conform our hearts to the Lord Jesus Christ, that we might have the mind of Christ, that we might have the heart of Christ, that we might have the life of Christ. Meet each need of every heart, home, and life, and family here this morning. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I want to tell you what Adam and Eve discovered. They discovered the vital, the terrible, the awful, the sobering truth of Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7. And here's what it says. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. You know what we're going to find out about today? We're going to find out about the curse of sin and the death that it brings. Doesn't sound exciting, does it? That's not all we're going to find out about. We're also going to find out about the wonderful, marvelous love and grace of God in providing the Lord Jesus Christ to take care of that curse of sin for us. Someone said this years ago, life is short, death is sure, sin is the curse, Christ is the cure. Christ is the cure. Now, let me just say by way of introduction, we're living in a generation that does not fear sin like it ought to. You know what? Sin is like a coiled up rattlesnake. Anybody want to go near coiled up rattlesnake? Not me. A coiled up rattlesnake, you know, he's in position to strike and he's ready to inject that deadly venom into his prey. Sin is an awful, contagious, deadly disease. Sin is full, it's filled with death. But you know what? We have a generation today that's blind to the devilish destruction and death of sin. They're just running headlong into it. Someone wrote years ago, sin will take you farther than you want to go. Slowly but wholly taking control. Sin will leave you longer than you want to stay. Sin will cost you far more than you want to pay. But we have a generation today that does not fear sin. But here's a sad part. We've got a generation of Christians today who don't fear sin like they ought to. We've got a generation of Christians today who want to dabble in sin. They want to dabble in sin. They want to play around with sin. They want to toy with sin. They want to get just as close to it as they can. They want to sort of dart in and out of sin, and they think they can get away with it. But I want to tell you something. I don't care whether it's a non-believer or a believer. One day there's coming the sober reality of the hurtful, harmful, hellish destruction that sin brings, the devastation that it brings. Well, I want you to notice first of all this morning, we're going to consider what happened after Adam and Eve sinned. Well, first of all, their sin immediately turned into shame. Their sin immediately turned into shame. Did you notice that in verse 7? And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, this is something they had never experienced before. They had never experienced this feeling before. This feeling of guilt and shame and dirtiness. They had never felt that before. And I believe they said, why do we feel this way? Why do we feel so naked? Now remember, we looked at this earlier, I told you that before they sinned, they were covered with glory, the glory of God, and they were clothed in a robe of light. Because Psalm 104 and verse 2 says, who covers thyself with light as with a garment. God wears a robe of light and glory. That's why when he appears, we talk about the Shekinah glory of God. The amazing glory and light of God. Remember the transfiguration of the Lord Jesus Christ? The Shekinah glory of God. And you see, God made man in his image. And so man is enveloped by the glory of God. In fact, Psalmist said in Psalm 8 that man, he crowned man with glory. And so here's man enveloped in glory and wearing this robe of light. But what happened? You see, when he sinned, he fell short of the glory of God. And the glory of God departed from him. And he's no longer clothed in this robe of light. And now he has this awful sense of nakedness, this sense of guilt and shame that he's never had before. Their sin turned to shame. Now listen to me carefully. I'm not glad that Adam and Eve sinned. But I am glad that when they sinned, they had this deep sense of guilt and shame. Ezra said in chapter 9, verse 6, and said, "Oh my God, I am ashamed and blush to lift up my face to thee, my God. For our iniquities are increased over our head, and our trespass is grown up unto the heavens." You know what he's saying? He's saying, "Dear God, I am so ashamed of our sin, I can't even look up. I cannot even look into your face." Now listen, it is never good to sin, of course. But it is good that when we sin, we have this awful sense of guilt and shame. Because some people have sinned so much and they've sinned for so long, they have become hardened in their sin and they no longer have a sense of shame and regret and guilt. And their conscience has become seared and it's become shipwrecked and it no longer bothers them. And Jeremiah was speaking to his people and he talked about this very thing and he said this: "Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? Nay, no. They were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore they shall fall among them that fall. At the time that I visit them, they shall be cast down, saith the Lord." They were so hardened by their sin, they couldn't even blush anymore. They had no sense of shame and guilt. Folks, you realize that's where we're at today. I wish I could give you a better report. That's where we're at in our country today. We have a generation of unblushables. Unblushables. But folks, listen, it gets even worse. I want to tell you, Paul, with tears streaming down his face, talked about the last stage of human depravity. And here's what he said: "For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly." That means whatever they want, whatever they desire, that's their God. "And whose glory is their shame, who mind earthly things." You know what he's saying? These are people, and not only have they lost the normal sense of shame concerning sin, they actually glory in the vile, wicked things that they do. They're arrogant about their sin. Let me tell you, they're proud of their sin. And the sin that used to slink down the back alley now struts down Main Street. That's what he's talking about right here. That's what we have in our country today. You've been keeping up with what's going on in North Carolina? Folks, can you believe it? I'm telling you what's going on in our country today. And I want to tell you, and it's sad, I hate to make this statement. We have a generation that is laughing themselves right into hell. That's what's going on. That's what's going on. Now, notice what happened to Adam and Eve. First of all, their sin immediately turned to shame. Number two, and you see it very clearly, they immediately tried to cover their shame. See? Immediately they tried to cover their shame. Look at verse 7 again. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and they made themselves aprons. Oh. That sin turned into shame, and they said, we've got to cover this up. And they were very cunning, very clever. And so they came up with this plan, and they sewed these fig leaves together. What were they trying to do? Well, they were trying to cover their shame. They were trying to make themselves garments to cover their sin. They were trying to cover their sin. Now, what's this represent? It's obvious, isn't it? It represents all of the organized religion in our day, all the cults, all the movements and religions that are trying man-made ways and making man-made garments to cover their shame, to cover their sin. That's what it represents. And there are so many different garments man tries to make to cover his shame and to cover his sin. But you know what? There is not a man-made garment that can cover your shame and that can cover your sin. There is not a man-made garment that can cover our sins before the all-seeing, all-knowing, everywhere present eyes of Almighty God. It's not going to happen. And today, so many people are dressed in garments of their own making. Man-made garments. And listen, I mean, outwardly, they look religious. Outwardly, they look pretty good. But I want to remind you of what it says in the book of Titus, chapter 3, beginning in verse 5. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, not by our man-made garments, but according to His mercy He saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by His grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Amen? Amen. Folks, you'll never be able to cover your own sins. You'll never be able to come up with a garment to cover your sin. Good works won't do it. Religion won't do it. Water won't do it. Nothing will do it. Save the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, step one, their sin turned to shame. Step two, immediately they tried to cover their shame. Step three, their sin and their shame led to separation. Separation from God. Look at it in verse 8. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. What happened? Sin had driven a wedge between God and man. Sin had brought forth this separation. You know what I'm certain of? I was thinking about this. There's not a doubt in my mind about this. Adam and Eve made those garments, and they were pretty proud of them. You know what? They felt pretty good about it. They felt pretty good. And I believe Adam said, "Honey, you look stunning in that new dress." And I believe Eve said, "Honey, you look awfully handsome in that new suit." They were proud of what they had done. You see, that's man-made religion is proud of itself. A do-it-yourself religion is proud of itself, you see. And I want to tell you something, they felt pretty good. Until, you know where I'm going, don't you? Until God showed up. And I want to tell you, when God showed up, all of a sudden, they didn't feel too confident. All of a sudden, they didn't feel too comfortable. And I believe Adam looked over at Eve and said, "I'll be honest with you, I don't feel too good." And she said, "You know what? Funny thing, I don't either." And you know what they did, don't you? They headed for the bushes, didn't they? I mean, they ran and they hid from God, tried to. You see, they were still separated from God despite their man-made garments. And boy, they realized it when they stood face to face with the Lord. They realized how infinitely insufficient their man-made religion really was. Well, they found out they couldn't hide from God. They found out distance wouldn't do it, darkness wouldn't do it, fig leaves, trees, none of this would hide them from the all-seeing, the all-knowing, the everywhere present eyes of God. They found that out. They discovered that very quickly. And you know what? Over on the side was the devil. And I want to tell you, he had a sly smile on his face, that old serpent, because he had accomplished exactly what he set out to accomplish. Exactly. And that was to separate God and man. And he had accomplished it. And I want to tell you, he was proud of himself. Oh, the fellowship that they used to have. Oh, the communion that they used to have. You see, God is to be known. He's to be loved and enjoyed. We're to know Him and to have wonderful fellowship with Him. But look at them now. They're afraid of God. They're running from God. They're hiding from God. Separation. Isaiah talked about it in chapter 59, verse 2, "But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid His face from you that He will not hear." And again in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, "For the wages of sin is death." That means separation from God. But I'm glad I can share with you another step now. Step 4, that separation led to seeking. That separation led to seeking. Now here's the good part that'll make you want to shout. It wasn't Adam and Eve seeking God. "Oh, I want you to see something right here." Hey, right on the threshold of the temple of truth, the Bible, right in the vestibule of the Word of God. Here is a beautiful, beautiful picture of the amazing grace of God. Now watch it right here in verse 9. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? God was seeking Adam. There's the amazing grace on display right there. Why do we love him? Because he first loved us. Isn't that what the Bible says? Because he first loved us. And here's God moving in mercy because of the pitiful plight of man. And here's God with love and compassion, mercy and grace and forgiveness and long-suffering, moving because of the pitiful plight of man. Here's God taking the initiative. God would have been perfectly just to let them go on in their sin and let them die in their sin. But thank God for his love. Amen. Thank God for his grace and his mercy, his compassion, his salvation. And you know, when God came down to the garden that day, he knew all about what had happened. He saw it. He knew it. Folks, he didn't come down as a detective. He didn't come down as a policeman saying, where are you and what did you do? That's not the idea here. No, when he came in love and he came in compassion and he came with a broken heart. And he said, Adam, where are you? Where are you? You know what? He came seeking. He came seeking and he came to save. He came to save. You know what the good news is? God's still seeking and saving today. That's the good news. He's still doing the same thing today. He's still calling out and, where are you? And he's still seeking and he's still saving today. Why? Because he loves you. He loves you and he's not willing that any should perish. He is not willing to let you go on in sin and die and go to hell. He's not willing to let that happen. Luke chapter 19 and verse 10 says, For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Revelation 3 and verse 20 says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17, the last invitation in the Word of God. And the Spirit and the bride say, Come, come. And let him that heareth say, Come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. That's God's heart. That's God's heart. Well, there's another step. This seeking, God was seeking. This seeking turned to searching. God's going to search Adam's heart now. He wants to bring Adam face to face with his condition. David said, Search me, O God, and know my heart. That's the idea. So after he sought Adam, he searched Adam. He tested Adam and he asked Adam some questions to bring Adam face to face with his sin and with his separation and with his condition. You see, the old preacher had it right. He said, you got to get them lost before you can get them saved. And what he meant by that was you've got to help them understand their lost condition. They've got to be able to see their lost condition before they'll realize and recognize their desperate need for a Savior and for salvation. Now look in verse 10. Adam is speaking to God and he says this, I heard thy voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. God responds in verse 11, "Who told thee that thou wast naked?" Now, God's not trying to gain information here. God already knows all this. Again, let me say again, God is trying to get Adam some information. He's trying to get Adam to realize what's going on and to recognize his condition and his sin. That's why God's asking the question. God doesn't need any information. He already knows it all. Now watch what he says. "Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat?" God already knew. He wanted Adam to confess. "And the man said, the woman." Oh. The woman. What a confession. "The woman, whom thou gavest me." God, what did you do to me? That's what he's saying. I'm telling you, that's what he's saying. "Whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat." Wasn't my fault. "And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the devil made me do it." Right? "The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat." Now, you see all the alibis there. You already know this. We've talked about it before. You know all the alibis and the excuses. But God is trying to bring them face to face with their sin. And nobody's willing to say, "It's me, O Lord. I'm guilty. I did it. Oh God, have mercy on me. Look what I've done." Now you see a bunch of excuses and a bunch of alibis here. See, man never wants to believe it's his fault, right? You know that there's a defense mechanism built into your flesh that will always try to preserve itself and blame somebody else. We call it blame shifting. "You know why I did that? Because you did this. That's why I did that." What's that? What's that saying? It's your fault. "You know why I act so bad? Because it's your fault. If you acted right, I'd act right." That's blame shifting. That's this defense mechanism that's built into us that always says, "It couldn't possibly be my fault. It's got to be somebody else's fault. It must be somebody else's fault." So, as you know, Adam, not only does he blame Eve, he blames God. It's amazing. He actually says it's God's fault. And he blames Eve, and of course Eve blames the serpent, and of course the serpent doesn't have a leg to stand on, right? So, but the bottom line is they're all saying the same thing, right? They're all saying, it's not my fault, it's not my fault. Everybody is being blamed. But nobody wants to say, "Yes, it's me. I did it. I'm the one." Nobody is saying what David said in Psalm 51. "I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is ever before me." But here's God trying to bring Adam and Eve to that place of recognition. So they can come to this place of confession. They're willing to acknowledge and they're willing to confess their sin before God. Proverbs 28 and verse 13 is a verse you ought to learn. You ought to memorize it. "He that covereth his sin shall not prosper." But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. That's a verse you ought to learn. That's where God was trying to bring them. He wanted them to see themselves as they were. Sinners. Lost and undone and separated from God. And in need, desperate need of a Savior and salvation. And this is the last step. Praise the Lord, it's the best one. Searching led to a Savior. Searching led to a Savior. Folks, here is one of the most wonderful and amazing prophecies in all of the Bible. And it's right here on the front pages. We're going to get to it in verse 15. Look at verse 14 leading up to it. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. In other words, you're going to bite the dust. That's what he said. You're going to bite the dust. And listen, judgment was pronounced on Satan at that point, and there was no longer hope for him. That's it. In fact, Matthew tells us that hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. By the way, have you ever recognized what that verse is saying? Hell was never prepared for man. God never intended for any man to go to hell. It was prepared for the devil and his angels. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all, A-double-L, should come to repentance. God, our Savior, who is willing for all men to be saved, Paul said in Timothy, book of Timothy. See, never meant for man. Never meant for man. Oh, but then our Lord says something that's thrilling right here. I want to tell you, in fact, verse 15 is the seed bed of all prophecy. It's the seed bed of all prophecy. Here is the first gospel sermon ever preached. And it was preached by God Himself. The congregation was Adam and Eve. Now look at what He said. Verse 15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. You know what we see here? We see a battle is prophesied. We see a birth is prophesied. And we see a bruising is prophesied. Notice that a battle is prophesied here. God says to Satan, I'm going to put enmity. Remember, that word enmity means warfare. I'm going to put enmity between you and your seed and the seed of the woman. In other words, God is declaring war on Satan and on sin and on the effects of sin. And ever since that time, a battle has been raging between heaven and hell, between light and darkness, between righteousness and unrighteousness, between good and evil, between Christ and Antichrist, ever since that time. And by the way, we see it raging, don't we? See it raging in our country. We see it raging in society. We see it raging in our neighborhoods. We see it raging in our homes. Let me let you in on a little secret. Do you know who's going to win? Well, listen to me. It ain't going to be the devil. It isn't going to be the devil. Every once in a while, South Carolina comes out of me. A battle is prophesied, but I want you to see a birth is prophesied. A birth is prophesied. Boy, I'm telling you, this is good. This is good, even if I am preaching it. It's good. And I will put enmity, warfare, between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. Now, our Lord says, all right, that he declares war, and he says, let me tell you how I'm going to win this war. I want to tell you how I'm going to win this war. One will be born of a woman, and this one will not only defeat Satan, this one will crush him. That's what God is saying right here. Now, did you notice he said one born of the seed of the woman? Folks, there's something good here. Huh? He didn't say of the man, one born of the seed of the man. He did not say one born of the seed of the man and the woman. He said one born of the seed of the woman. And right here, right on the front page of the Bible, we have a wonderful prophecy of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. Because listen, we don't just need a substitute. We need a sinless substitute. And as you know, the human nature, the sin nature is passed through the seed of the man. And that's why the scripture and God declares here, this one who's coming is going to be born of the seed of the woman, and this one will be sinless and therefore qualified to be your Savior. And he's going to crush the head of Satan. So God declares war. And then he tells us how he's going to win this war. One is going to step out of heaven to earth, be born of a virgin, be sinless, and be our Savior. Now lastly, not only do we have a battle prophesied and a birth prophesied, we have a bruising prophesied. Look at the next part of verse 15. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Satan says to the serpent, to the devil, there's one coming, born of a woman. You're going to bruise his heel. I want to tell you that happened at Calvary, didn't it? That happened on the cross at Calvary. Isaiah chapter 52 and verse 14 says this, one of the most amazing verses in all the Word of God. As many were astonished. They just couldn't believe their eyes at his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. They beat Christ until you couldn't even recognize him. And then Isaiah 53 and verse 5 says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. Wounded. God said, you're going to bruise his heel. Wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised. Just like the Lord said, you're going to bruise his heel. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Folks, that's what happened at our Lord's first coming to this earth. That's what happened. Satan bruised him. Satan bruised him. But did you see what else verse 15 says? Look at it. It shall bruise thy head. There's a difference between a head and a heel. A head speaks of something that's lethal and fatal. In other words, it's going to be a lethal blow. It's going to be a fatal blow. See, there's coming a time at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ when Christ comes back in all of His majesty and all of His honor and all of His glory and all of His mighty power. And He is going to crush Satan. He will absolutely crush him. And you know what's amazing about this prophecy in verse 15? It not only prophesies the incarnation of Christ, Christ coming to this earth, not only the incarnation, the coronation of Christ. I mean, it just covers the whole thing right here in verse 15. And yes, it's true that Christ has already defeated Satan by His death, burial, and resurrection. But you see, Satan is still in operation. He's still in operation. But there's coming a time at the second coming of Jesus Christ, He is going to totally crush him once and for all. What a day that's going to be. There's a war going on. Folks, choose sides very carefully. Choose sides very carefully. Because I want to tell you something about the devil. He is selling a sinking ship. It's going under. It's just a matter of time. You need to board the old ship of Zion. Get on board the ship of the gospel of God. I mean, do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? There's a hymn that says, who is on the Lord's side? Are you on the Lord's side? I want to tell you something. If not, you need to cross over and get on the winning side. You need to get on the Lord's side, because I want to tell you something. Life is short. Death is sure. Sin is the curse, but thank God Christ is the cure. Let's pray. Our Father, we love You and thank You. You are so good to us. Thank You for Your amazing grace. Thank You for Your abundant mercy. Thank You for the forgiveness You have extended to us by and through the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father, there is no greater joy and privilege and blessing than to be in Christ and on the winning side. How we thank You. And Lord, I pray until that day when we see Christ, You'd help us to be faithful. Faithful soldiers. Lord, willing to endure hardness for Your sake. Not entangled with the things of this life, that we may please You as You have called us and chosen us to be soldiers. Lord, I pray You'd help us to be faithful till Jesus comes. Father, I pray as You look upon hearts, You would meet each need of every heart here this morning. If there's one here without Christ, they would be brought to the recognition and realization that Adam and Eve were, that they're sinners and their sin separates them from Thee, but that Jesus Christ bridged that gulf of separation by His cross, by His death, burial, and resurrection, and in full faith they'd turn and put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and in Christ alone this morning. For each believer, help us to be faithful. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I feel like we ought to sing a song of victory this morning, because we're on the winning side. So I want you to turn to 587. 587. We'll just sing that first verse. Victory in Jesus. Let's stand together as we sing.